I won't remember to do that, so. All right, how to improve loving relationships. A husband and wife have been married for 60 years. Oh, time out. I'm a little ADD, if you didn't know that. I met with a couple this week who's been coming to church here the last 6 months. They told me that they have not been to church in over 50 years, and now they're coming to Surfside, and they want this to be their home. So I think that's just a wonderful thing. See, God does use donkeys. A husband and wife had been married for 60 years and had no secrets except for one. By the way, don't do like church last night. People were giving the punchline away before I finished. We have people in the audience who will take you out. They'll punch you right in the throat. A husband and wife had been married for 60 years and had no secrets except one. The woman kept in her closet a shoebox that she forbade her husband from ever opening. But when she was on her deathbed, and with her blessing, he opened the box and he found one crocheted doll and $95,000 in cash. My mother told me that the secret to a happy marriage was to never argue, she explained. Instead, I should keep quiet and crochet a doll. Her husband was touched. Only one doll was in the box. That meant she had been angry with him only once in 60 years. Don't give it away. I see you back there. Don't give it away. But what about all this money, he asked. Oh, she said, that's the money I made from selling dolls. So if you're like, that's not funny. I got a box full of dolls and I can't sell them. So today we're going to talk about relationships. So we're going to start with the negative side, because you need to understand what you're doing wrong before you figure out what you're doing right. And the Bible talks about that. So we're going to talk about why relationships go wrong. And we're going to start in Romans chapter 12. If you have your Bibles or you have it on your app, we'll have it on the screen. You can look it up later. If you're going to follow along with me, a lot of times you'll have to get ready, because I move pretty quick. But here's what I want to say before I get to this part of the message. I'm going to leave that up for a minute. Oftentimes as Christians, we think of spiritual things, I'll put that in quotes, like praying, differently than we think about doing. And because of that, what happens sometimes is we think of spiritual warfare only being something we do on our knees, or something we do in our prayer closet, or something we do when we're praying for people. But here's what I want you to realize. God has called us not to just be hearers of the word, but doers. And it says in Scripture, don't be overcome by evil. And then it says, but overcome evil with good. So here's what that means. You're creating an atmosphere where you are. Some of you have an atmosphere in your home right now that's very negative. You may have a relationship with someone right now, and before you even talk to them, you just sense it. Okay? Now, some of that is spiritual in the sense that you think of spiritual. Yes, you need to pray. You need to pray that God will give you a breakthrough. I was praying something very specific this week, and God answered me very specifically. I actually had a person come up to me and say, this is what happened. I said, that's exactly what I was praying. So God does that. But if you and I pray a lot, but we don't do what's right, then we're also creating an atmosphere. Part of what you do spiritually is with your hands. Remember, Jesus was going to heal people, and they came to him, and it didn't say that, and he just prayed for them. No, the Bible says he touched them. When the little children came to him, he blessed them. But you know what he did? He laid hands on them. He prayed for them. And so part of it is doing. So don't get in your head that there's this spiritual part of your life and there's a physical part of your life. We as Americans tend to Tupperware things, but the Bible never Tupperwares things. We're physical, spiritual, emotional, and it's all in one Tupperware. That's why when you're tired, you come to church and you haven't heard a thing I said yet. Some of you are hungry. Some of you are hangry. So you need a Snickers, right? And so it affects all of us. And so that's why we're going to talk about this doing part, but realize that it's not just doing either. It's also praying and asking God to help you to do these things. So it's all combined. Don't separate them into two separate things. All right? So let's talk about why relationships go wrong. Number one, we stop listening. Stop listening to each. And we don't, why? We can't, what the other is saying to us more. By the way, the sound guy's like, what the heck? Because as we're listening, but talk to us, what we're doing is we're on our Facebook. And so we, about every word of what they're to us. And so we don't know what they're talking about because we are not full attention to them anymore. Does that sound familiar to you? You paid more attention than you did all day today. Because you're wondering if my words are actually coming out or if I'm just holding back at times. Is this not the weirdest thing you've ever seen from the stage? It's like a bad Japanese movie. Look out! It's Godzilla! Number one, we stop listening. By the way, if you find out that somebody's not listening to you, you can do what I used to do as a child. I would make up stories. My sister will tell you to this day, we'd be sitting at the dinner table, and if I didn't think anybody was listening, I would be like, and then I blew up the world. My sister, ha, 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 and the other kids are like, why is she laughing? Here's what it says in Romans chapter 12, verse 16. We're going to start there. Live in harmony with one another. Some of you could just take that verse, put it on your refrigerator, and it would change your life. Because here's the deal. This word harmony in the Greek means to think the same thing. But I love that the translators made it the word harmony. Because here's the deal with harmony. In harmony, you do your own thing, but not by yourself. Your job is to support what the other person's doing, to blend into what they're doing. So sometimes as you're seeing people sing, you'll see them put their hand on their ear. My Sharia amor, pretty as a summer day. Right? My Sharia amor. By the way, that song's very special to me because when I was in fifth grade, it's in North Carolina, a little hayride. The girl that was a teenager, I started singing that. She said, you sing so good. My Sharia amor. Do you live in harmony? You can't live in harmony unless you're listening, unless you know what they're thinking. Listen, I want you to think of somebody that you need to improve a relationship with today. It may not be your spouse. It may be somebody at work. It may be somebody at home. It may be a child. How can you live in harmony with them? You have to understand, what are they saying? Not what did they say, what are they saying? So husbands, when your wife says you never, she doesn't need you to give a list of when you did. You never do this. No. Actually, on April 3rd, okay, you're missing the point. What are they really saying? A wife said, I once gave my husband the silent treatment for an entire week. At the end of which he declared, hey, we're getting along pretty good lately. Husband and wife jokes are so easy. Number two, we become prideful. Number one issue, pride. Pride's what separates us. Knowledge puffs up, love builds up. We start thinking we're better. Don't be proud, but be willing to associate with people of low position, Paul continues. Do not be conceited. Now, all of us, nobody thinks they're prideful. If I said to you, are you prideful? You, oh, no. I'm the humblest person in this room and I'm proud of it, right? So let me throw a few things at you to check your pride. Do you think you're better than someone who speaks differently than you do? Maybe you feel like, you know, maybe you were born somewhere up north and so you hear somebody. How y'all doing today? Y'all getting along all right? Got my overalls on. No shirt. Right? And you instantly think you're better than that person. Or last night we had one of our Bostonian friends, Nancy, in church. And Nancy's that Bostonian person. I can't do a Boston accent at all. Who you think, that person's so rude. And I say to you, Southerners are just as rude. We're just nicer about it. When we say bless your heart, we really don't mean bless. There's another word we would put in there if we were from the North. One that cannot be repeated in church. In the Roman church, what was happening is you had about a third of Rome that was slaves. And so these were people who served everybody, and they all went to church together. And what was happening in the church is they were dividing based on who they could get power from or authority. Listen, if you pay attention, do you only hang around people who can help you? There are people who only hang around people who can help them in some way. The Bible says, be willing to associate with people of low position. People who can do nothing for you. They might even seem a little slower than you are. But do you think they're better than you? You're better than them just because of that? I don't consider my mechanic dumb. He talks a little slower. But I can't fix anything he can fix. We need to pay attention to that. Now, I'm going to give you one that hits close to home. You ready? Buckle up. Here it comes, Buttercup. You ready? When you're on Facebook and you see a grammatical error over and over, do you think that person is as dumb as a bag of hammers, right? Do you think you're better because you've got that one area down? Do you see how pride sneaks into everywhere? All right, this one's going to get really painful. So somebody doesn't vote like you vote. So here's what happens, because I have friends that are on all sides of the aisle. And each one of them says, those people are idiots if they believe that. And then the other side says, you know, those people are idiots if they believe that. And so I realize that everyone's an idiot at this point, right? But we tend to think we're smart, they're dumb, that's the real problem. And then they do these stats, you know, most of America's uneducated. And of course, we assume they're talking about whoever we don't like. They're uneducated, right? And we build pride and arrogance. And what happens when you do that? You can't listen, you can't change, you can't discover. We have to get rid of pride. And America needs a little humility. Number trace, that's three. Not listening, pride in our lives. Number three, I'm bad about this one. We keep score. We keep score. If you are a servant-hearted person, you do this. You don't mean to. It's just natural to you. You see who cleaned out the dishwasher last. You know who did the dishes at the office. You're aware of who loaded the paper in the copy machine. I mean, you're keeping score. You don't mean to. You just are. I don't mean to. But you think you're better because of that. And you think you deserve something better. And when that person, something good happens to them, you think, oh, they're not the one who does what I do because I've been keeping score. Look at my side. By the way, nobody can see your chart, including your spouse. Please don't get a chart out for your spouse. Do not repay anyone evil for evil, but be careful, Romans continues, to be careful to do what is right in the eyes of everyone. So what is this saying? How can you repay? You can't repay unless you're keeping track. Are you keeping track? If you're always trying to get even, you can't love people. Marriage is not 50-50, it's 100-100. Divorce is 50-50. Marriage is 100-100. Well, Eric, that's not fair. You didn't come to me for marriage counseling, did you? Because I would start there. I'm so tempted. I still haven't done this, but 1 Corinthians 13, everybody wants to read. That's the love passage. Love is patient. Isn't that great? Like, you realize that means long suffering, right? Nobody can say, I didn't warn them going in. Number four, we create strife. Do you know a drama mama? great. I've done this sermon all weekend. That was great. It was great. Do you know a drama papa? It might be a little different, Adam, but there's both. Everything's a big deal, right? If it's possible. By the way, it's not always possible. If it's possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. So do your best to make peace, even with that person, and make sure you're not that person. By the way, if when I said, is there one relationship you're struggling with, you couldn't think of one because you had 100, it's you. Okay? So I want you to think of one person that you're struggling with today that you could apply this message to, how I can help. You know, we notice what we want to notice. So we tend to focus on what we focus on. And the problem is, if you're in relationships for a long time, what happens is you tend to focus on the negative instead of the good. I had a couple that I did their wedding over 20 years ago. Just a few years ago. And what I tell couples when I do their wedding, I say, listen, if you struggle, you can come back to me. Now let me tell you something. I'm a terrible counselor, but I'm free. So come on back. So they came back. They wouldn't even come together. They said, we're really struggling. I don't know if we're going to be able to be together. And I said, let me ask you a question. Why'd you marry them? Which I love, because people tend to do this. I don't know. I'm like, no, really. Remember why you married them. And what I do when I'm doing premarital counseling, I sit with people and I say, what do you like about them? So the girl will say, I just love it that he's funny. I'm like, really? Because you're not going to one day. Because he's going to be sarcastic and it is not going to be funny. No, I'll always think he's funny. And then about a year later, they come back to me. They're like, it's not funny anymore. My favorite, this happened. And I couldn't help myself. I try to behave when people are talking. This is why I'm a terrible counselor. Because you're supposed to just, when people are talking, you're supposed to go, mm-hmm. And I don't do that. So the guy says to me, I love that she's honest. And I went, ah! I said, really? That's what you like? Oh, yeah. I think it's great. She just tells me like it is. You're right. That's just a great trait.
Long-suffering.
And I said, that very thing you love is going to be the very thing that drives you crazy. Because she's going to be honest when you don't want her to be honest. And be like, I didn't need to know that. She's always honest. Tell me your opinion about it, right? You know, we just go on. Why? Because we begin to focus, and then we hyper-focus on the wrong thing. You ever bought a new car? Or a used new car? I have a 10-year-old car. When I got my car just a few years ago, I noticed all of a sudden everybody's driving a Nissan. Everybody. There's actually 4 cars exactly like mine in Titusville. Tinted windows, same year, same color. Mine has stickers on it. I've thought about taking them off so you can't blame me for the bad driving, but... Still working on it, I was driving yesterday, I said to my son, okay, I know you're getting ready to get your license, don't do this. So, John, I didn't think you could do that. You can't. Hypocrite. Anyway, okay, so.
We confess our sins, he's faithful and just.
So what do you focus on? You focus on what you focus on. And typically, if you get into a relationship and you begin to see what's wrong, guess what? You're going to start to follow that train. Abraham Lincoln used to say, if you look for the bad in people, you'll find it. And if you need help, listen, those of you who are looking for the bad in me, I'll make you a list. Go ahead and get your time up with you. Leave the church now. Instead of on the way out, telling me all the things I did wrong. I'll give you a list now of all the things I do wrong. Can't believe the pastor. He's a doofus. By the way, if you're mad at your last pastor, you'll be mad at me, so you better get over that too, all right? Number 5, did I say all that out loud? Number 5, we stuff and explode. We are turtles and skunks. And typically turtles marry skunks. Please don't look at your spouse and go, skunk, okay? Don't do that. By the way, there's an Italian person that said when 2 Italians get married, it's 2 skunks. Wasn't my joke. All right. Ephesians 4 says this. Therefore, each of you, listen to this verse. You've probably never seen it this way. Each of you must put off falsehood and speak truthfully to your neighbor, for we're members of one body. We usually separate these two sentences. I want you to notice what happens next. In your anger, do not sin. Well, what does anger have to do with putting off falsehood? I'm getting there. Don't let the sun go down while you're still angry, and don't give the devil a foothold. Most of us know that last part of the scripture. Here's what that's talking about. Recognize when you're angry. And let me be honest about that. Sometimes, when it talks about being truthful, the truthful part of anger is sometimes you're angry because you're selfish. You're angry because somebody didn't do what you wanted them to do when you wanted them to do it. Or they didn't do it the way you wanted them to do it. Or they didn't think of you or consider you, or you felt left out, or you felt rejected. So you're angry because you didn't get treated the way you want. And if you really look in the mirror and you're truthful, you're just selfish, and you just need to say, I'm angry because I'm selfish and self-centered. But sometimes there's a reason we're angry. Somebody hurts us. Somebody attacks us. Somebody says something false about us. And so what do? We're supposed to be truthful about that. Remember, though, the Bible says speak the truth in love. If you wait until you're totally frustrated, then you will explode. And even if you're a turtle, exploding turtles are no fun. So skunk or turtle, every time you get angry, if you just explode or you store it up and then you just let them have it, that's not good either. What? So speak truthfully. Speak truthfully. Speak lovingly. Don't allow it to become bitterness. Because what happens? Bitterness then makes you continue to focus on the wrong, focus on the wrong, focus on the wrong. Seneca, 2,000 years ago, may have been friends with Paul, by the way, said this: if you wished to be loved, love. You want a more loving home? Than you love. So let's look now. How can we improve relationships? How can we change this spiritual atmosphere we're talking about? How can we do some things, pray in the middle of this, and do some things that'll change it? Number one, honor each other. Honor each other. Love must be sincere. Hate what is evil, cling to what's good. You see the focus changing? You don't like what's evil, but guess what? You're hanging on to the good. It doesn't say hang on to the evil. So you don't have to like it. You don't have to like what they do. You don't have to like the things, the behavior, but you hang on to the good. Be devoted to one another in love. And then listen to this. Honor one another above yourselves. This word honor in the Greek is an easy word. It means to value. So ladies, if this afternoon you were home and all of a sudden you got a knock at your door, and Tom Selleck was there with a rose, would you just slam the door in his face? No, you'd be like, you might have some questions. Yeah, I'll be your Valentine. What? Oh, I wasn't asking that. I'm lost. You know, whatever. But you would listen. Wouldn't you pay attention? You would value him. Gentlemen, if Christy Brinkley at 65 years old showed up at your door with a rose, I'd like to see the man of the house. You'd pay attention. Tom Papa, I love it, and he talks about how the difference between new couples and married couples. New couples go out to dinner. They're sitting with their menus. The waitress comes by. Are you ready? Oh, yeah, I haven't even looked yet. I love you, love you, love you. Married couples going to the restaurant. They don't even look at each other. They're just like, I'm just glad I'm not eating your food tonight. Menus, waitress comes by. He's like, I want blah, 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 blah. If she even hesitates, he's like, come on. We don't want that table to get in front of us. Order now, right? They go to a show together. People who are dating. Hey, are you cold? Would you like a soda? Here's a sweater. You can have my jacket. Did you spill something? I'll go get it. Married couples at a show. They sit down. She says, I'm cold. Hey, we're out, aren't we? Get it yourself, right? What happens? We quit valuing each other over time. Some of you need to start dating again. Some of the single people are like, yeah, I really do. Some of you married people need to start dating again. Take time to value the person. Number two, appreciate your differences. Cooperate. You appreciate your differences when you're walking in the middle of the night and you catch your toe on that dresser. How many of you, I'm just going to ask you, how many of you thought about your pinky toe this morning at some point? You thought about your pinky toe? One person. Can I ask you why? I can't. You hit it. Broke it. Right? So we typically don't think of our pinky toe until something goes wrong. Listen, every relationship, you are different than each other. if not one of you, is not necessary. So realize if you're in a relationship, there are weaknesses that each of you have and strengths that each of you have. And you don't always see eye to eye, but you cooperate. For just as Romans 12, 4 and 5, just as each of us has one body with many members, these members don't all have the same function. So in Christ, we, though we are many, form one body, and each member belongs to all the others. See, Paul, once again, in Romans, is talking to these Romans that are very different from each other, and he's saying, but you're all important. You all matter. I can appreciate what you're good at. I can appreciate that my husband is funny. Sometimes, right? I can appreciate that my wife is really, 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 really honest. Right? Can you appreciate that? Number three, not only do we honor and appreciate, we have to endure in tough times with hope. The enemy wants to take your hope away. One of the number one things that they've noticed is couples that divorce lose, somebody loses hope. It says it'll never change. The enemy wants you to lose hope in your life. He wants you to be discouraged. He doesn't want you to see a future. He doesn't want you to see anything changing. He wants you to lose hope. Why? Because when you lose hope, you become self-centered. When you lose hope, you quit making any changes. 1 Corinthians 13, this is the verse I talked about later. This is the Amplified Version, which basically does all the different meanings. Love bears up under anything and everything that comes. It is ever ready to believe the best about every person. By the way, we tend to think of ourselves, we think of our motivations rather than our actions. So if we do something wrong, we think, well, I meant well. But when we see other people, we immediately think, oh, I did that with the wrong intention. Think the best of every person. Its hopes are fadeless under all circumstances, and it endures everything without weakening. Now, here's the three things that if you miss everything else, I want you to pay attention. This is called the kindness challenge. They've done studies. Almost 90% of relationships improved if they did these three things. So I want you to think of a relationship that needs improvement. Now, if you think of 30, you're in trouble, okay? But think of a relationship that needs improvement. Here's the three things to do for 30 days. Here they are. Number one, don't say anything negative to or about the person for the next 30 days. Now, you think you're a positive person until you take that first challenge. And then you start going, you mean I can't even tell my best friend about what they did this morning? Exactly. You are not helping anybody, and you're hurting your own attitude towards them. So don't say anything negative to or about them for 30 days. Number two, tell them what they are doing right daily. Now you may have to stretch for it. But if you pay attention, you will find things they're doing right. So look for that and tell them daily. And then number three, look for a way to bless them every day. It may be something simple like a text. It may be a flower. It may be bringing a donut to work. It may be finding out what their coffee is and doing it. Maybe a gift certificate. Just simple. It doesn't have to be anything complicated. It doesn't have to be anything expensive. Just a way to bless them each day. So those are the three things. Don't say anything negative to or about them. Tell them what they're doing right and look for a way to bless them. And then finally today, number four. We honor, we appreciate, we endure, and then let God fill you with His love. This is the part where you spend time in God's Word. When you allow God's Word to sink in, you allow Him to soften your heart, and He does this. This is what real love is. By the way, this verse is what separates Christianity from every other religion. This is what God's love is. It's not our love for God. Basically, He's saying it's not how much stuff you do. It's not your religious activities. It's not all the spiritual things you think. That's not the part that matters. It's God's love for us. Why, what did He do? He sent His Son to die in our place to take away our sins. Dear friends, if God loved us that much, we should love each other. No one's ever seen God, but if we love each other, God lives in us and His love is made perfect in us. And Jesus believed this so much that one of His prayers before He went to the cross was that other people would see God because we love each other. God has the ability to make you less selfish and more loving. And that's what you need to begin to pray. If you've never prayed, God, you help me to love. God, you help me to put my selfishness out of the way, because with selfishness you can't love. So God, help me to love like you would love. Not to be a doormat, not to just be walked all over, but can you, from your side of things, love? And God, would you fill me with your love? Not because of what that person does, but because of what God's done for you. That's what love is. If you're here today and you've never given your life to Jesus Christ, you can do that today. I'll be here after the service and you can come and say, Eric, I know about Jesus, but I've never given my life to him. I'm not a Christian. I thought I was because I knew about him, but I've never surrendered my life to Christ, and I want to do that today. I believe he died, and I'm a sinner. I want to give that to him, and I want to give him my life. Maybe you're here today, and as I talked, one of these things stood out to you. Be honest with God about that. Say, God, I really struggle in that. Would you help me with your spirit? And know that your spiritual warfare is not only your prayers. You need to be praying. But it's also your actions. And ask God, God, you show me not only how to pray, but what to do. What to do. Let's go to the Lord in prayer today. Father, as we prepare for our time of offering, our time of giving, Lord, I pray first of all that we could give you our hearts. That, Father, those things that we take back, those times that we think that we can love on our own, Father, forgive us for that pride. And Lord, I pray too that you would fill us with your love. Not because we're strong enough to love. Father, in our own flesh, we're selfish and self-centered. So, Lord, I pray even right now, if somebody's watching online, that they would begin to see and to sense the power of your love. Father, for that person that feels lonely today and they've gotten focused even on their own selves during this time, I pray, Father, that you would begin to fill them with your love so that they could look for people to love and to care about. Help them to not lose hope when they feel hopeless. Father, I thank you in the middle of the season where we talk about love and lots of hearts. Father, I know there's people with broken hearts. So I want to pray that you would restore those who are brokenhearted, like you said in your word. And Father, you also said you're close to the brokenhearted. That's a promise. So Father, thank you that you're close to them. May they sense your presence today. Father, we invite you to continue to move among us in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to take our offering right now. Our ushers are coming. I'll be here after the service if you want prayer.